Money Talk for 2018. My name's Duane Rigsby. I've got Dave Apsley on a remote site. I'd like to welcome him in right now. Dave, good day to you. How are you doing today?
Great. Thanks for inviting me in. And too bad we're not outside like we were last time, but we can make this happen from a distance.
Oh, yeah. Yep, absolutely. Dave, I think you got some great information about passing land on to your family members. Is that what you're talking about?
I do. OSU has a couple new resources that we've brought online. I'm going to share a screen with you.
Okay.
We've got two resources that we're fortunate enough that Paul Catanzaro from the University of Massachusetts and Allison Muth out of Penn State put this together for multiple states, and then we kind of tailored it for Ohio. So we've got a video and a publication that's available for folks who are thinking about transitioning their land. It's never too early to start talking about that. But both of them can be found at this website, u.osu.edu/SEOhioWoods. And with that, we'll start with this short little video, and then we'll have a little discussion.
Your land is part of your legacy. Whatever drove you to purchase it, a place to raise your family, beauty, privacy, an investment, something to pass on. The fact is, your land represents more than just a dollar value. There's an emotional attachment to it, not just for you, but probably for your family. What happens to your land is up to you, so there are some important decisions to make. Take the Millers. Bob Miller has always loved snowmobiling. Kay Miller loves birds and spending quiet mornings taking walks on their trails. Now, they're approaching retirement and thinking about what will happen to their land after they die. Who will own it? How will it be used? They'd like to preserve it and not have it fall into a developer's hands where it could be turned into a housing development. And they'd like to leave it to their kids. At the same time, they want to ensure that the value of the land is available to them if they need it in retirement and can be distributed equally among their children when they're gone. It sounds complicated, this business of making everyone happy. Unfortunately, for couples like the Millers, it can lead to indecision, inaction, and outcomes they don't want. Family arguments, the land being developed, even legal battles, hard feelings and resentments that can linger for years. They've seen these decisions tear other families apart. What you may not know is that protecting your land is easier than you think. It's even possible to protect one portion of your land while allowing another portion to provide income or options for the kids. For example, Bob and Kay could place a conservation easement on the land, preventing future development and preserving its natural condition forever, while also setting aside three house lots that can be sold in the future. The house lots can provide income if needed later in life or be given to the kids. They'll even get a tax deduction for donating the easement to a land trust or the community. Of course, this is just one option out of many that will allow you to pass your land on, meet your financial goals, and ensure it isn't used for something you don't want. Bob and Kay are exploring their options. You owe it to yourself and your heirs to explore your options too. It's your land. Don't let it be the cause of fighting in your family. Take steps now to determine its future and your legacy. To start exploring your options, contact your local extension office today. You might be surprised at what you can do to ensure your legacy and just how straightforward the process can be.
That was quite an interesting video, Dave, about passing land on, and I like the information about how it splits, how you can kind of set some land aside. That's kind of cool. I didn't realize you could do that, I guess. I've seen people, you know, parcel their land off, but kind of, but I didn't know you could keep it for a lengthy time.
Yeah, there are lots of different options. They get very complicated. Most landowners, you got two kids or three kids, they want to divide the land up evenly. And that's kind of our first impression. But what we're finding is a lot of people that do that, they kind of set themselves up for failure, because if one of them can't make that happen or do the tax purposes, a lot of times then the land isn't able to stay in forest land or in the farm or in the woodlands. So we'll talk about some of those different options as to how you can do that. lives on or takes on the ownership of that, and then your other assets go to them. So there's lots of different options.
Okay.
And every family's different.
And I'm sure it could be a battle. Or, you know, you might be able to luck out and everybody's free, which sometimes is very hard to find.
Yeah, and the one thing for sure, if you don't plan, you don't have the discussions, you're probably going to have more problems. And if you have it, you make your wishes clear, and you make sure that everybody understands where you're coming from.
Absolutely. Dave, you've got some information, some slides that you want to go through.
I do. Let me share you just a couple of slides with you.
Okay.
Let's see. Did that pop up, Duane?
Yes, we have it.
So this legacy, you know, you own the land. It's kind of your legacy, something that you can pass on. So you really need to combine, you know, what you feel about your land, your stewardship ethic, but you also need to communicate that with your future owners. So, you know, if you've got children you want to pass it on to, or your spouse or whoever. And then it takes some folks who have knowledge about real estate and taxes and legal issues to get involved too. So you got to combine all those things. What's kind of scary is most woodland owners would like to keep their woodlands in a woodland, but they don't really communicate that. Nobody wants to face their mortality. And very few, only 35, this is actually Pennsylvania data, but it's not a lot different than Ohio. Only 35% have even discussed the plan with their kids. And only about half of those people are confident their heirs are going to maintain it as forest land. So unless you make the plan, there's a pretty good chance that it's going to be passed on. You know, it's not going to remain in forest land. So what we recommend is, you know, think about why you own that land, how you use it now, what are your concerns in the future, and what do you want to happen? You're the one that's purchased it. You've got your blood, sweat, and tears and memories and all that in the land. So it's important to have those discussions. You kind of have a mission statement. You know, where do you want to go in the future with this plan? And then listen to your heirs, potential heirs. You know, a lot of times we assume we know what our kids are thinking, and I've got kids. I've got one in New York City and one that lives here in Jackson and at home with us, and one who just got a job is working out of Athens. So it's really important to have those discussions. You know, what do they love about the land? Are they interested in carrying it on? You know, is that something they're even interested in? And if they are, you know, do they really realize what they're getting into?
Yeah.
And we really, you got to have the discussions. It's hard. Nobody wants to get together and have these discussions. And we don't recommend doing it over the holidays. We recommend setting some time aside to have the discussions. And bring up things like, I need your help thinking about this. Or bring up the instance where you knew somebody that had a family member that passed away and how the family fought. I know my dad, one of the things he made very clear before he passed away is he didn't want to fight. And his family went through one of those battles, and it stuck with him. And he said, whatever happens, you guys aren't going to fight over whatever we have, which we didn't have big property to fight over. But that's something you definitely want to avoid, and it tears families apart. So just having those discussions with the potential heirs is really important. And then just having those memories, you know, thinking about it. This picture of my son, he's now 18 and about 6 foot tall. But these are the kind of memories that you want to talk about. You know, listen for what they're interested in. Listen to the words they say. And then have these conversations. You know, understand what they're thinking about, and hopefully they'll want to carry that on. But kind of come up with that shared plan. What do you want to do? And make sure we're all on the same page. That's all it really amounts to. And then what don't you want to happen? You know, you don't probably want it developed or sold in the house lots or whatever. Maybe you do. But that's up to you, and those are discussions you need to have. Because you don't have it when you assume. And then gather up those resources. Make sure they know the work you've been doing. This is a shot from a program called My Land Plan from my property. And I've got plans. I've got maps. I've got a forest management plan. And, you know, they need to really understand the workings of that woodland. And have you hired a forester or a wildlife biologist? Who are these people you're working with to manage your land? Make sure that information gets passed on to your potential heirs. Just, it does a couple things. It helps them understand what you're getting into, too. And then get them ready. You know, programs like our Day in the Woods program is a great way to spend time with your heirs. If you can pull them away for the day and go to a program, we had a landowner whose son, he came, started coming with his son in 2012. He's since passed away, but the son and daughter-in-law come to our programs regularly, and they're carrying on his legacy. So by making those connections, you know, while you're able, it's really important. Get them trained, get them the resources to be able to carry on the mission. And I'm just going to move through. Create this team. You know, your heirs have got to be part of that discussion. Your natural resource folks that you work with, your financial advisors, your attorney, your accountant. You need to get these folks together and do the planning, get things on paper before it's too late. And really, you're doing your heirs a favor, because this is a stressful thing. And if they're always saying, what would Dad and Mom want with the property? Well, you're not leaving any doubt with all that. You're having those discussions up front. Everybody's on the same page. Nobody has to assume anything. And then have that land mission statement where here's what we want to happen jointly with the land, and work with these folks to make sure it happens. Again, I mentioned earlier, sometimes equal is not always best, especially when it comes to dividing property, because with inheritance taxes and all that's changing, but it's possible you split it up and then you're kind of set in this process in the motion where your land, about the only option for them is to have to sell it to be able to pay the bills. So that's what we want to try to avoid. And think about what's fair and not necessarily equal acreage, because it's hard to divide a property equally anyway. If you've got other assets, maybe you can give some of those assets to one child where you're giving mainly most of the property to another. But try to think about and avoid leaving it in equal parts, unless you have a real substantial property that's pretty tough to do. And more than anything, create these memories. These are pictures of my kids early on, and these are memories that I cherish, and I think it's important to have the discussions and think about it. A great place to go to get more information is mylandplan.org. It not only has the planning tools that I showed you earlier, but it also has a whole section on Pass It On. And if you go in there and create a little account, it gives you lots of hints and lots of starting places on how to pass that land on. So with that, I'm going to stop sharing the screen and we can finish our discussion here.
Pretty interesting stuff, Dave. I've gone through some land disputes, I guess, like that too, so or other family members and such. And I've seen other families do the same thing. So, and they didn't go to get all their paperwork drawn up to like to a lawyer or any of these things. And I think it's really good to try to get this out to people. How do we find more information about this, Dave? Just go to your website, the blog, or
the blog site, u.osu.edu/SEOhioWoods is a great place to view this video, and there's a publication that goes along with it. It's a several-page publication that gives you a lot of the starting points.
Mm-hmm.
If you have a property that's more of a farm and a farm business, one of our educators, David Marison, out of Ashtabula County, has a nice series of transition fact sheets to get more into the farm businesses, where it even gets more complicated if you've got family members living on the farm and living off the farm income. Most of our woodlands, you know, there might be a small source of income, but you don't have families that have to actually create all their income off of that property. But Dave's got a series of fact sheets out there as well that you can find on our Ohio Line site.
Okay. Thanks. Awesome information. Anything else that we need to do to wrap this up or put it in a basket for everybody? Do you do presentations on this on a regular basis, or just when somebody asks?
We're just starting to do it. I did my first one on it back in March of this year. So I've got some resources, but I'm a landowner. I'm in the same boat as a lot of other people, and it is a tough subject to broach. We're going to try to pull more resources together, especially the legal and the financial. financial side of things, that's where we need to build up our resources a little bit. And again, our ag folks have done a lot of that as well.
Yeah.
But stay tuned. We'll have more information as we can develop it.
Yeah, I think it's certainly a project worth following through and giving all of our clients as much information as possible.
Yeah,
could be a very valuable resource in the future.
It can be. It can be a very valuable resource. It can be a nice asset for folks. Provide a little bit of a comfort there. But it's just so important to have those discussions because time flies and, you know, you don't want to have to deal with this when you're not able to do it. So stay tuned. We're going to look at it. We've got our schedule set for a day in the woods for 2018 through November, but it's a topic I think that we'll eventually do a day-long program and try to do more on it. Several other states have some great resources as well. Penn State, if you search legacy planning, and Penn State University has some wonderful stuff out there. Oregon State does too, but it's more Western focused, so there's some differences. But certainly dig into it and start having the discussion. As hard as it is, it's important there.
Mm-hmm. Speaking of just a few more minutes in the day in the woods, Dave, anything else you want to plug that you got coming up? That's a great thing to go to.
Yeah, just go to the blog site. We have the calendar scheduled. Actually, tomorrow, the day after this airs, is our first one, so it'll be too late to sign up for it. But we've got a series of programs on the second Friday of every month. In June, we're going to do one on breeding birds, so that's going to be the next one that comes up. And highly recommend you check it out and spend a day with us mostly out at the Benton Furnace State Forest.
All right. Dave, I appreciate all the information. So we're going to talk to everyone next time, and who knows, we might be talking about birds or anything like that.
Sounds good. Thanks, Duane.
Thank you.